Good afternoon, brethren. This is the 25th still of October, at least here in Spring Valley, Assembly of Yah. And this is our last and final official convocation, our second meeting on this Sabbath. It's a Sabbath day, and it's, of course, it's an annual Sabbath day. And we greet everyone on the outreach program out there, and we hope that you are enjoying the feast tapes that have been produced and Yahweh is blessed here. Not just tapes, but all the things that made the tapes, all the praising and rejoicing and stories and love and everything. We pray that this message of love and kingdom and power and victory has come through that little camera lens and reached out and touched everybody out there too.
Hallelujah.
Because Yahweh is able to do it. Right, Cora? Hallelujah. Okay. Just an announcement. I'm sorry you won't be able to join us out there in Movie Land, but we're going to have pictures, photographs, and get everybody together and get all kinds. We got 13 film pictures left on our camera. We got to get pictures of everyone and just do all that. We make up a scrapbook every year of feast pictures, like maybe you do. And so we can remember all those smiling faces and stay in touch with them on the telephone. And of course, you know, when you've had a very special, touching, powerful feast with one another, there's a spirit here. And I think all of you are aware that we feel differently this week than we feel usually most of the year. He puts a special spirit of bonding and love, and he opens up our spiritual eyes as part of his gifts during Tabernacles. And you can look back to Tabernacles almost any time, probably almost any of the feasts, and just feel, boy, you know, when I was there, I just felt so loved. It was so good. There was so much caring and sharing. It was just a family that was perfectly in tune with one another like no other time during the year. There's a special spirit here. He gives us every opportunity, every chance through his spirit to be what we want to be and what he wants us to be. And that spirit is going to carry on with us, we hope, through another 6 months till we get to another feast. We'll live from 6 months to 6 months. But maybe the pictures and the videos will help that feeling and that love and that spirit carry on just a little bit longer. And we're all going to miss you here. And you know, you might say to yourselves, we've been through this before, this isn't the first day out of the bag, as they say in the business. We might say, we just want to all come back same time, same place next year. We all want to come back here. But you know, we have to go where Yahweh wants you to go. We may never get together like this again, these same people. Isn't that we don't want everyone back. It's just that maybe Maurice is sent someplace else next year because he's got something he's got to share there. Or whoever it is. Whoever is here, wherever they may go. We all are from all over different countries. No one here lives within 200 or about 250 miles of here. The closest person's one, just one, Judy. She's 5 miles. Everybody else is 250, 300 miles or California, from Illinois, California, Oklahoma, all over Michigan. Well, enough said about that. This is our last meeting, and we need to focus and have focus this morning on freedom. Freedom we have had in the spirit. Freedom in knowledge. Freedom from bondage. Freedom from the world. To choose. Yahweh gives us freedom to choose, and we have chosen him in his way, his plan. Because it's the best. And not only is it the best, and the outcome is magnificent beyond understanding, but he helps us if we choose that. He will help us send helpers, send the spirit, and so forth. And Roy, we had a good message about what's it like, what are the characteristics of a believer. What was the title?
Kingdom bound.
Kingdom bound, what the people are like that are kingdom bound and have to be like. The kingdom requires obedience. If you'd like to send to Spring Valley here, Assembly of Yah, we have a tape. The kingdom requires obedience. Believe it. Yahweh talks about responsibility and obedience with love for each other and him. And we're obedient out of love. We'll have a message this afternoon on something that everybody here is familiar with, but we know that the Bible is alive. Every time, almost every time you read a verse, you get something different out of it, some other slant, some deeper message. So he's always talking to us. His word is never boring, never the same. It's alive. And of course, the carnal mind cannot know it, neither can it understand it, because it's spiritually discerned. So when I was reading through last night, I felt that maybe I would give a message, and I was looking through something, and this story, which I'm not going to tell you about now, just jumped out at me. I thought, well, that's we look at that all the time. That's just average common stuff. And I started looking at it, and it started exploding before my eyes and bubbling like I'm mixing something in a test tube. And I thought, whoa, there's something powerful here. So the message this afternoon will be Mysteries, Secrets of the Kingdom. Now, if that don't tickle your ears, there's nothing else I can do. I might as well just sit down and Yahweh give up, and he doesn't give up. He doesn't slumber or sleep. And this is Yahweh. This is not me. So we'll continue with the program now, as we always do, and turn the program over to Beverly for worship and praise.
So everybody got their music? With the lamb on the front, and we'll sing the second song down, Yah is So Good.
Yah is so good. Yah is so good. Yah is so good. He's so good to me. I love him so. I love him so.
I got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, sets the captives free. I got a river of life flowing out of me. There is no well. In my soul, spring up, oh well, and make me whole. Spring up, oh well, and live to me.
To walk and love.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How about soon, very soon, on the next page, the very top, page 4.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we are going to see the King.
How about on page 6, the second song, Thy Loving Kindness, Psalm 63, 3 to 4.
6 or 5?
Well, I think you got it on both pages.
Oh, have I?
Mm-hmm.
Are you ready? Want to start it?
Thy loving kindness is better than life. Thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise thee, thus will I bless thee. I will lift up my hands unto thy name. I lift my hands up unto thy name. I lift my hands up unto thy name. My lips shall praise thee, thus will I bless thee. I will lift up my hands unto thy name. Thy loving kindness is better than life. Thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise thee, thus will I bless thee. I will lift up my hands unto thy name. I lift my hands up unto thy name. I lift my hands up unto thy name. My lips shall praise thee, thus will I bless thee. I will lift up my hands unto thy name.
Hallelujah. What about on page 7, the very top one? You know that one, Bernice? Wherever I am.
Yes.
Okay, let's make this our last song. Page, top of page 7.
Wherever I am, I'll praise Him. Wherever I can, I'll praise Him. is the name of Yeshua. Lift up the name of Yeshua. For the name of Yeshua lifted me. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. I go to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. When all the world's sinking sand, just a solid rock I'll stand. Where there's shelter from the storm, I go to the rock. Wherever I am, I'll praise him. Wherever I can, I'll praise him. For his love surrounds me like a sea. I'll praise the name of Yeshua. Lift up the name of Yeshua. For the name of Yeshua lifted me. I go to the rock of my salvation. I go to the stone that the builders rejected. Go to the mountain and the mountain stands by me. When all the world is sinking sand, and on the solid rock I'll stand. When I need shelter from the storm, I go to the rock.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is our rock, isn't he?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Keeping with the theme of secrets and mysteries, there is a secret mystery in the scriptures that not too many people know about. And this is primarily something the young folks ought to be aware of. And it's something that's very prominent nowadays. And it has to do with evolution, too. Now, we don't believe in evolution here at Spring Valley. We know that Yahweh created the world in its entirety in 6 days.
Hallelujah.
And this is some of the proof of it. Now, I want you to turn with me to Job. I gave this some time before in other places. Quite some time ago. But it shows without a doubt the creatures that are talked about in many places in the teaching of evolution were alive and doing very well in the time of Job. And it starts in chapter 40, and yes, that's it. Chapter 40, it starts with verse 15. In this scriptures, it's called behemoth. Now, behemoth means in the dictionary something very large. Now, we do know that we have some large animals still alive and doing well on the earth. And one of them that's mentioned in the scriptures is called a unicorn. Now, that's in another place, but anyway, you can look it up for yourself. It describes the strength of a unicorn. It's a great, powerful animal. It is not the animal of mythology that's weak, a little goat-like animal with a narwhal tusk sticking out of his head. No, there was never such an animal on the face of the earth. No way. But there is an animal that's still doing well in places like India and the African subcontinent. And that animal is extremely strong. It's powerful enough to turn over a truck. And when a unicorn is that strong, it has to be something other than a mythological animal. And that animal is a rhinoceros. The rhinoceros is the unicorn of the scripture. Now, in that same light, and here in chapter 40 of Job and verse 15, behold now behemoth, which I made with thee, he eateth grass as an ox. Now, contrary to most opinion about a dinosaur, most were not meat eaters. Most of them were vegetarians, as man once was, as he was created. And he ate vegetable matter, and many of the fossil remains bear this out. That he was able to digest and use vegetable matter, much the same as our modern day iguana. And the fact the iguana looks like a miniature dinosaur in many ways. And it goes on to describe this animal. Verse 16, lo, now his strength is in his loins, and his force is in the navel of his belly. This animal was extremely strong, and for its size, it was still very strong, and it had tremendous large legs, able to get about very well, some of which lived all their lives in the water, or had their bodies supported partly by the water and in deep swamps and so forth. The fossil records show that too. And we know also that the fossils can be made much sooner than millions of years. We know that from an account of a man that was still alive recently had made a horse trough out of wood. In his area, the mineral water was such that it petrified that wood, and he was still alive. Some experts came over and looked at that thing and thought it was millions of years old. Okay. They took samples of it even to be analyzed the ways that they analyze it with the nuclear radiation, and that too bared out that it said it was millions of years old, but the man that made it was still alive. So we know that things can be fossilized much, much sooner than what the experts are telling us. And anyway, in this account, it shows without a doubt it could only be one thing. In verse 17 it says, he moveth his tail like a cedar. Well, we know that a cedar tree is very large and very strong, and there's no other animal ever was on the face of the earth that had a tail like a cedar tree. Now, elephant has a very small tail, and so does a rhinoceros, and so does a hippo. But a dinosaur had a very thick tail, and he indeed used it like a cedar tree. He could smash his enemies with it because it was so strong. The sinews of his loins are wrapped together. This animal was so well built that there was hardly anything could hurt it that was alive at the time. His bones are as strong as pieces of brass. His bones are like bars of iron. He is the chief of the works of Elohim. He that made him can make his sword approach unto him. In other words, Yahweh only was the one that had power over this critter. And it says, surely the mountains bring forth food where all the beasts of the field play. Now, a lot of these creatures were in shallow, slow-moving rivers where his food was brought down to them by the approaching water. It says here, he lieth under a shady tree, in the covert of the reed and the ferns. Now, we know that they had such places like that. In fact, the area of Iowa and western Illinois at one time was under water. And we know also that the central lower part of Michigan also was under water because of the salt deposits. The coal deposits here in Illinois were part of that swampy area that was once his domain. Behold, a river sweepeth violently along his path. He is not alarmed. Why should he be alarmed when he lives in the river all the time? And he's so large, it really don't matter. Because to him, it's just like taking a bath for us. Mm-hmm. He remained quiet, as though a Jordan rushed out to his mouth. They could have a big flood. He wouldn't care, because he is well able to handle deep water. And then it says, can anyone catch him when he is on watch or pierce his nose by means of snare? And so it shows without a doubt that this could only be one thing. And now my Bible in the next chapter says crocodile, but we know that can't be either. Many places crocodiles are, and they're not that large. But a dinosaur would fit there very accurately. Canst thou draw out the dinosaur with a hook, or his tongue with a cord which thou let down, like you catch a fish? Canst thou put a hook into his nose or bore his jaw through with a thorn? And the thing is, you try to catch him with a hook, and you never try that again. It says, will he make many supplications to thee? Will he speak soft words unto thee? You couldn't tame this thing. There's no way. Will he make a covenant with thee? Will thou take him for a servant? You know, we've made servants out of elephants, and some have even made them out of rhinos, but this critter, there's no way, because he had a mind of his own. We know the elephants are well able to do many chores for mankind. In India, they're used for logging and many other chores, and for loading things, and they're very strong. And they'll obey the mankind. Even a child can make an elephant work. But in verse 5 it says, will thou play with him as with a bird, or will thou bind him for thy maidens? Shall thy companions make a banquet out of him? If it's anything like an alligator, crocodile, or many other reptiles, you can cook them and cook them all day long. Pressure cook them even if you want to, until the meat becomes the consistency of a rubber truck tire, and that's about all they're good. The only thing that they're crocodiles and so forth are good for is for eating little crocodiles, and I think that's the same way it was with the dinosaur. It says, verse 7, canst thou fill his skin with barbed irons, or his head with fish spears? Lay thy hand upon him, and remember the Bible, thou will do it no more. There's no other critter on the face of the earth that has that attribute, because we know there are people who go out hunting alligators and catch crocodiles, make suitcases and shoes and so forth out of them, but not this critter. You would never be able to catch them and make anything out of it. Behold, the hope of him is in vain. Shall not one be cast down even at the sight of him? None is so fierce that dare stir them up, carry him up. Who then is able to stand before me? He was making a comparison. If Yahweh made this critter, who's going to be able to stand before me? See? That's the comparison here. Who hath shown me favor that I should repay him whatsoever is under the whole heaven is mine. I will not conceal his parts, nor his power, nor his comely proportion. Who can discover the face of his garment? Who can come to him with a double bridle? I know of no way this critter could be made to pull a wagon. Who can open the doors of his face? His teeth are terrible round about. Now, we know from the things they've dug up in Dinosaur National Monument, the way the teeth were arranged, and the largeness of the head and everything, there's nobody would be able to open up his mouth. It says, his arched sides are as pride, shut up together as with a close seal. And it's talking about his scales here. One is so near to another that no air can come between them. They're like bony plates on the sides. They are joined one to another. They stick together that they cannot be sundered, cannot be broken apart. By his kneesing, a light doth shine. His eyes are like eyelids of the morning. Now, if you know what a large reptile's eyes look like, when he opens his eyes, he's got instead of blue or blonde or black or brown eyes, his eyes look like the sunshine coming up in the east. It's golden. It's just like it is in a frog. And so it shows, and going down, I'll skip down here, it tells about nostrils and smoke and so forth. And we know in the cool weather, he would breach his breath just like a whale because he's that large. It says in verse 23, the flakes of his flesh are joined together and are firm in themselves and cannot be moved. And his heart is as firm as stone, yea, his heart is a piece of millstone. We know that reptiles can have hearts that can remain beating outside the animal for at least 24 hours. They're that tough. When he raises himself up, the mighty are afraid. By reason of breakings, they purify themselves. If you've seen one of these things close by, I think you'd wind up doing the same thing. Purifying themselves mean they literally went in their pants. They were so frightened. Their knees smote violently together, I guarantee. The sword of him that layeth at him cannot hold. The spear, dart, or the habergeon, he esteemeth iron as straw and brass as rotten wood. The arrow cannot make him flee, and sling stones are turned with him into stubble. Clubs are counted as stubble, and he laugheth at the shaking of his spear. Sharp stones are under him, he spreadeth sharp pointed things upon the mire. He maketh the deep to boil like a pot, he maketh the sea to, like a pot of ointment. He maketh the path to shine after him. Well, we know a ship going through the sea makes a path like that too. So this is not an alligator or a crocodile. Upon the earth there is not his like, and who is made without fear. He beholdeth all high things. He is the king over all ravenous beasts. So, right there, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, is proof that the dinosaur indeed was alive and well on the earth at the time of Job.
Yeah.
Surprise ending.
the impression that the secular world and all its schools and all its knowledge and encyclopedias, they're lying to us.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
They're lying to us in a whole bunch of ways. But Yahweh's word is truth.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only truth there is. And finally we come to that realization that we're not going to get truth anyplace else. And then we get the realization that that truth leads to something better.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, when that truth is opened up, you find some secrets. You find some answers to mysteries. Boy, we got in that message. All right, here we go. The last great day. Mysteries. This is entitled The Mysteries of the Kingdom. And I like mysteries. I like secrets. I like esoteric information that nobody else knows. I want to know all the secrets and all the things Yahweh knows. I want to know everything that He knows, but that probably is never going to happen. I know you feel the same way. You want to know stuff. Yahweh, like a father. Direct comparison. Yahweh, like a father, has secrets. He knows things about his family that the children don't know. He knows things about his wife that maybe his wife doesn't even know. He knows secrets. And he manages, just like a manager of a company, a president, a CEO, he manages knowledge and uses that knowledge to run his company. And because the carnal man wants power over others, he won't share a certain amount of knowledge because he's holding it onto his own empire within the company. You know, we've heard that. Mm-hmm. Yahweh isn't like that. Yahweh wants to tell us almost everything. And Yeshua, we've already said in the days that we've been together, Yeshua calls us friends because I tell you what I'm going to do. So let's start with Deuteronomy 29:29, one of my favorite verses. This is right out of the King James again. This morning we heard mysteries. We know we not this morning, but we've heard about the mysteries or a secret, mystery of iniquity. We know that Paul said, I will show you a mystery about the change. There are mysteries. And we heard someone say, I think it was Maurice, that these things are not mysteries anymore. But there's some other things that he has shown us that we know, but I think today it will be a revelation, some deeper knowledge, I hope, that he's shown us, is showing us here, of things we thought we understood, but maybe there's deeper understanding. In Deuteronomy 29:29, Yahweh says, the secret things belong unto him, our Elohim, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of his law. So there are a great many things that belong to Israel, the believer. They belong to us. Now, he didn't say others, everybody. He said us. And I tell my daughter, I said this earlier in another message, I tell my daughter that if we learn the word, learn about Yahweh, keep his commandments, and if we keep his commandments, we know him. John said that. That she will learn and know the secrets of the universe. I don't know if you ever watched scientific programs back in the 50s and 60s. There were science hours. They would teach you secrets about how atoms worked and things in the scientific world and how the world works together and molecules, the atomic chart. Remember the atomic chart with all that stuff up there you couldn't memorize, couldn't understand? I almost flunked chemistry. He says it belongs to us forever that, or maybe because, or so that, we may do all his law. Because when we see what we've been talking about today, this week, the big picture, when he starts revealing secrets and revealing knowledge, it lifts him up, it lifts us up together, that we want to do. He is so magnanimous, he is so charitable, he is so benevolent, makes us want to follow him, trust him. And I hadn't seen that before. That we may do all his law. What does law have to do with secrets? Not a direct connection, an indirect connection. And that the secrets that we're going to talk about today has to do with law, and even more pertinent, the call of salvation to the kingdom. How would you like to know? How many want to know the secrets of the kingdom?
Oh, yes.
Right? Okay, everybody on the outreach program, I look through there, we see at least 20 hands on the camera. Hallelujah. In Matthew 13:11, he said, because it is given, they said, why are you speaking in parables, Master? You know, I'm going to paraphrase here, and I don't mean to be cute. This is what the apostles meant. You're speaking in all these parables, and they're not getting it. The crowd, you want to reach these people? They're not getting it. You're all speaking in these stories, these funny stories, and you're not communicating. If you want to communicate and spread this good news you've brought, you're going to have to change your approach because they're not understanding. You're always speaking in parables that they don't understand. Do you realize that, Master, that they don't understand what you're saying? And he said to them, they said, why are you always speaking in parables? He answered them, he said, because it is given unto you to know the secrets or the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them it is not given. Mm-hmm. These are secrets. We know secrets, and there are more secrets to know and understand that he reveals to us, Israel, the true believers. Secrets are revealed because we are co-inheritors with Yahshua. That's why. Because we are part of his kingdom and co-rulers, co-leaders, co-owners of the kingdom. So if you have a partnership between two people, those two partners are going to share information. They're going to share the secrets of how you're going to manage this company. They're working together. And that's exactly how this works. You all of us here are called as co-managers, leaders, and kings and priests, because that's exactly the term that's used in 1 Peter 2:8. To lead the kingdom, to lead others. Our responsibility isn't just to be righteous within the kingdom and keep his commandments and go to Tabernacles every year up at Jerusalem and all that. That isn't it. Our responsibility and calling is to manage and lead and encourage others. That's the calling of the kingdom. There is one verse that says, when we're changed and we're spirit, we will say unto them that are flesh in the kingdom, in the seventh day. This is the way. Walk ye in it. Mm-hmm. We're going to whisper that to them. And we're going to use the words, the right things, like the angels help us with and the Holy Spirit helps us with. We're going to help others. So the secrets are revealed. Why? You might say, well, why is he revealing secrets? Because we need to know this, and because we are co-workers, co-heirs in the kingdom. And I'm talking about the kingdom that lasts forever when New Jerusalem comes down too. The seventh day and the kingdom. Really, the proper terminology, the kingdom really refers to the spiritual kingdom when New Jerusalem comes, when there is no more flesh. The seventh day is really the 1,000 years millennium. We'll talk about that later. Secrets revealed. Daniel 2:28 says, but there is an Elohim in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king what shall be in the latter days. And that's to us too. Thy dream and the visions of thy head upon the bed are these. And he tells him, Daniel tells him what the dreams mean. He tells Nebuchadnezzar. Okay? There are people who have interpretations of dreams today. There are people that understand visions. One might have a vision, the other interprets. One has a tongue, the other interprets, all in order. Those are spiritual things, and they reveal things. Sometimes they reveal things that we never heard of, a secret or something that we need to know right here, right now, or it might be just a word of encouragement, something we've heard before, but right now this is going to touch us all and lift us up, make us stronger. John 15:15, he says, henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his master doeth, but I have called you friends. We've heard this many times during this feast. For all things that I have heard of my Father, doesn't everything come from Yahweh? He came to reveal the Father. He is a spokesman. He's called the Word. Everything that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. And here we go, because he's going to teach us some things. Let's go to Matthew 13, the book, the chapter of the parables. Matthew 13. And in Matthew 13, there are six primary parables. And each one of these has to do with the kingdom. It's a secret of the kingdom. What the kingdom is, how you get there, who's going to be called, it's a secret. It's a revealing of a mystery. Mysteries of the kingdom. And I'm not going to read through the whole chapter. I'm going to go to selected verses. So I will try to be clear of what verses that I'm on. It says in Matthew 13, verse 1, "In the same day Yeshua went out of the house and sat by the seaside, and great multitudes were gathered together unto him." That statement is very important. Great multitudes were gathered unto him. What does that mean? That's the seventh day. He's going to teach them. Great multitudes came unto him. That means more than just some people came around. So that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables. In parables. And the first one he talks about is, "Behold, a sower went forth to sow." That is the first parable. "And when he sowed, some seed fell upon the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured it up." I don't want to go into all those places and what they mean and all that. You have read that. The stony places. Who is the sower? What's the mystery? They didn't understand that. Yeshua is the sower. That he brought and manifested the word of Yahweh. He's called the word. He's sowing the word of truth like this. And you know, you can meet almost anybody in the world and they'll tell you that they've read part of the Bible, something out of the Bible at one time or another. They got some of that seed. The seed is the word. He told them that. Now the stony places, what does that mean? Stony places. Well, it tells how the stony places react. It talks about the path and the wayside, but the stony places is a hard heart. That's the secret. Some of that fell on a hard heart. Stony heart. Remember the verse talking about a stony heart? And now we have a fleshy heart. We pray for a fleshy heart. Stony heart cannot receive his word. And if it is there, it can't spring deep. It can't go deep because there's no earth. There's no place for it to go. And some fell on thorns. Some by the path, some by stony places, some by the thorns. The thorns is like a bad attitude. It's a heart that is corrupt. It might be reprobate. And if you could pick it up, if you could pick that heart up, it would prick your fingers. It would hurt you. And you get next to someone who has a thorny heart, and you're going to get stuck. These little darts and things are going to come out. They're going to be nasty. They're going to snap at you. There's nothing warm there. There's nothing soft there. You see the comparison, soft and thorny. And the thorns grew up and increased and choked them. And some fell on good ground. I want to go to the next one. I think it's verse 24. He said, "Another parable he put forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is..." Now, these are the statements. There's like four of these, right in a row. Five, I guess. And he says, "The kingdom of heaven." That's exactly what he says. He's not talking about the seventh day. He's not talking about just walking in righteousness in this earth. He's talking about the kingdom. And that's where we are today. Today, Yahweh would come back. And before he would come back, there would be a great judgment. There would be a great judgment. This parable now is the mystery of wickedness. Another parable he put forth in verse 24. "The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in a field." Now this is different than parable of the sower. This is not how the word fell on different places on the ground and how the ground reacted to the seed or how people react to the seed. This is the world. He is sowing the whole seed over the whole world. And how does the world respond? Like the world is a garden. "But while men slept," in other words, as time went on, that means people live, people die. People live, people die as time went on while they slept. Make sense? "His enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, the good word, then appeared the tares also. So the servants wanted to know, should they go out there and they want, should we tear the weeds out? And he said, no, no, lest you uproot the good fruit or the good branches, the good things that are growing. And so that we know, as a mystery, how is it that we can be in the world so diverse and spread out? We are called dispersia. And then there's so many wicked people around us and in between us and all around us. And even if you had a congregation of 20 or 30 people and you had an open door like Sam Graham does. Uh-oh, I mentioned a name. You would have all these tares coming in also. So when you stood up here and you ministered or whatever, you would see the wicked interspersed with the righteous. And who does that? Says the enemy does that. People will ask you, well, why isn't everybody converted? Or how can there be so many wicked? Why does Yahweh allow wicked? Because it's the enemy that came in and sowed wickedness. That's the mystery. That's the answer. When people ask us, well, why isn't he so powerful that he can just call everybody and convert everybody and everybody's holy and perfect and keeping his commandments and statutes and judgments? No, because there is an enemy. And some will not understand the mystery of wickedness and deny that there is an adversary who is sowing weeds, untruth, wickedness, rebellion, stubbornness. That's a mystery. But the mystery now has been understood by us. We understand that there's an enemy. So let's go to the next parable. Should be verse 32 or 33. The kingdom of heaven is likened unto leaven, which a woman took and hid 3 measures in meal of meal till the whole was leavened. What is this mystery of talking about? This is a statement that is a mystery of the kingdom, secrets of the kingdom. What is this leaven? What are the measures that the whole was leavened? Well, I think if I consider this, pray about this, that this thing that just takes a little bit and you put it in like a little leaven, leavens the whole lump. This is not sin now, but it's faith. It's the word of faith. His word shall not come back void. And if you put it in a lump or a group of people, given a right situation, it will keep spreading and spreading and spreading. And it's also how fellowship works. That if you have 2 or 3 people that are really up, really hot for Yahweh, and they are strong in their faith, and they witness, that will be contagious, won't it? That faith will be contagious, and it will spread, and it will touch and encourage the whole group. Leaven. Doesn't leaven raise up? Now, we're not talking about your days of unleavened bread where leaven is considered to be puffed up or prideful. But it raises up. It makes larger. It develops and matures what the bread that you're baking. And he says in verse 34, all these things Yahshua spake unto the multitude in parables. And without a parable he spake not unto them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. That was a parable, a prophecy given that this one would come, the anointed one, and speak in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundations of the world. If you talk to someone about fellowship in the world, they'll think friendship. They'll think about having a good time or a party, but they won't understand what we've experienced here. Right, Judy? They won't understand. It's a mystery that has been revealed to us. And we know that there are 3 primary ways to strengthen faith. Prayer, reading of the Word, and fellowship. Isn't it true? 3 primary ways. They don't understand prayer. That's a mystery. I mean, you don't even have to speak the words and somebody hears you. And 2, reading of the Word, that's a secret thing because the Word is secret. And it's alive. And it's moving around like a pot that has vegetables, a big pot of vegetable soup. If you look at it long enough, you see different pieces of vegetable come to the top. It's all different. It's always moving around. It's alive. And fellowship. The spirit of one person can touch the spirit of another person that touches the spirit of another person. We touch each other. And you know, you've heard the analogy that in a fire, you take one of those burning embers out with tongs, and as soon as you take it out of the fire, that fellowship with fire, was it to it cools right off, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But if you put it right back in there, it takes a little longer, but it'll heat right back up again to look like the other coals. So that's why it says, do not forsake the fellowshipping and the gathering thereof of one another together. Some of us here haven't been to the feast for 2 or 3 years. The feasts are very important. Not only is it obedient to go where Yahweh places his name, where he wants you, but that fellowship is critical. We're living from 6 months to 6 months. We need this fellowship. We need to see other people's faces, hear other people's stories, and hear their faith that touches us. And don't some of us say, boy, I want that kind of faith? Boy, she's strong, or he's strong, and they're strong, and that's a strong family, or whatever. And so we provide examples for one another and encouragement for one another. The feasts are very important. And he doesn't say, remember we said the first day, Yahweh doesn't say time out on all the stuff he's working with among each one of us when it comes to the feasts. He continues to work and use each other to rub up against each other at the feast. And we share, and we share good things. Which brings us to another parable. Should be verse 44, I believe. I wiped out some of my verses. Again, the kingdom of heaven, Yeshua says, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found a treasure. He's just walking along. Maybe he's walking his dog, Bernice. Or his cat. And he stumbles upon this treasure. And he looks around. I know. I mean, this is what I would do. Looks around to see if anybody else just happens to be on that field or has seen what he's doing, because he's looking down at what's standing at his feet, a treasure. Wow, what a discovery. And when the man hath found it, he hideth it. He hideth the treasure, right? He doesn't want anybody else to find it. He wants it. He covets it. And for joy thereof, I mean, he just goes screaming off into the sunset, right? For joy thereof, he goeth and selleth all he hath and buyeth the field. Now, what is that? That's not salvation. What is it that we will not give up?
Yeshua.
It's Yeshua, but how did we find Yeshua? I think it's Yeshua, but it's also something else. It's truth.
Buy the truth.
Truth. Buy the truth and sell it not. We're not going to give up the truth. And when we get the truth, we're going to not hide it, but we're going to bring it into our heart, and we're not going to let anybody touch it. You're not going to mess with my head about this. I know that the heaven and earth was created in 6 days, and he rested on the seventh. We're talking about 24-hour periods, and you're not going to mess with me about this. This is the truth. Yeshua is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man come unto the Father except by me. Nobody's going to mess with that. Nobody's going to mess with virgin birth. 3 days and three nights, 72 hours in the grave. Nobody's going to mess with that. Nobody's going to mess with the fact that he pre-existed from the foundations of the world. He just didn't come into existence when he was born in the Virgin Mary. It's not true. Any way you slice it, as a prophet says up in northern Illinois, any way you slice it, it's baloney.
Baloney, yep.
Right? And Yahweh came, I gotta say it, because it's out there a whole lot. Yahweh came, Yahweh was manifested in Mary, Yahweh died, and then he went back into himself. There is no son. Yahweh just came and did it himself, and he spoke to himself. When he cried out and he said, take this cup from me, he was just talking to himself. Someone said that he was using ventriloquism. It's foolishness.
The whole book of John.
Foolishness, yes, throughout the book of John. Oneness is a deception. The truth is, there are two. There's not one, like the Jews say, on one side, and three on the other path on the other side, don't turn to the left or to the right. There's two, Father and the Son, that's it. And we know that. Nobody's going to mess with that. I'm going to hide that in my heart.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to hide it so nobody can touch it. Nobody can take it from me. Steal it. Buy the truth and sell it not. Verse 45. Yeshua said, the authority. Yeshua said, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who, when he hath found one pearl of great price, went and sold all he had and bought it. Just like this other man sold everything else he had. We have got to be willing to give up everything and sell everything we have to hold on to the truth. Whatever it takes, that's what we have to do. And if we found a pearl of great, great wealth, and somebody didn't know what that wealth was, and they don't, do they? They don't know what the pearl of great price is. They don't know how much it's worth, and they don't see the value. So you go into this old knick-knack store, this resale store, and it's on the shelf for $3.75, or maybe it's $49. Earl Shive, $29.95, any car, any color. Okay? Right? Remember that? The auto dealer's back there?
Yeah.
Well, he's lying to us. He jacked up the price. But anyway, we go into this store with $29.95, and we know this thing is worth millions. And we act real coy and very wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove, and, oh, well, I don't know what I can do with it, but I'll give you the $29, and you buy it, and you take it home. And you're jumping for joy all the way home like this. You beat the system. You broke the, beat the clock, they used to say. Remember that program, Beat the Clock? What is the pearl of great price? Who think they know? Raise their hands.
I believe it's Yeshua, because he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Mm-hmm. Real close. Tell me what's round. What's round? What's big? What's more expensive than you would ever pay a price for? What did we say was created in 6 days? The earth. That's the pearl of great price. Does it touch you? Does it burn? Does it burn the hearts? The earth. The saints will inherit the earth. Hallelujah. She's smiling. I think she got it. I started reading this, and this started jumping out of me. I got goose pimples all over me. It's all in praise Yahweh. He is a revealer of secrets. We, the saints, shall inherit the earth. The pearl of great price that he created in 6 days, holy, was perfect. And it's going to be ours. Yes, Yeshua is a pearl also. But I can't think of a scripture right offhand that refers him to a jewel. He has diadems and so forth. Imagine him being in outer space, if we could, the fourth dimension of outer space, looking down on this beautiful, beautiful creation. It's a jewel. It's a pearl. It's a pearl. What will we sell? Will we sell everything that we could buy the earth? That we could have it for our very own. The difference between the elect in the first resurrection and anybody else is the analogy that I make. We own the candy store in the kingdom. They come in just to buy.
Mm-hmm.
We own. We're owners. Co-owners, co-inheritors, double portion, firstborn with Yahshua, first from the dead. Fits, doesn't it? We're talking real big picture now. Hallelujah. And he is wonderful. Yummy, yummy, yummy. The merchant is us. But you know, for us to find that treasure, we have to see that it is a treasure. And our eyes have to be open to understand that it's something worth grasping for. You know, we might say, I'd like to have, I mean, I don't think believers really say this, but people of the world might say, I want to win the lottery, $5, $7, $10, $17 million. I'd like to have a mansion like the Taj Mahal. But Yahweh offers us the whole world. Think of it. The whole world. Wow, that's powerful. Mm. Not because we're worthy, but He thinks we're worthy, and He can use us in that inheritance. Number 6, verse 47. Again, Yahshua said, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered every kind, which when it was full, they drew it ashore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, the bad, but cast the bad away. So shall it be at the end of the world. Because flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom, and there will be no wicked. We'll see in a few chapters here, in a few verses here, there can be no wickedness, no sin, nothing that works iniquity in the kingdom. So we have here someone that casts forth a net that we know that the angels, so to speak, judge in the last days. But we see here that the fish, all kinds of different types, there's another mystery he shows us, all different kinds of fish. He said, follow me and I will, what, Korah? Follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Right? You used to have a t-shirt like that. All kinds of different fish means all kinds of different people. Some we don't think are worthy. Some shine as bright as the heavens. But there's all different kinds. And we try to figure out, don't we? We sit down and try and figure out, what do we all have in common? Why did we call us? I wasn't worthy, and I was over here doing this, and I was over here doing that. And why do you think you were called? We try to figure out that mystery, don't we? How could so many different and varied types be called when none of us seem to be worthy and some worse than others? All basically the same in His sight. Because Yahweh loves everyone. And I think one of the key factors of being one of those fish that are kept is that we are willing to submit. We're willing to submit. We're not rebellious. Or at least we have repented of rebelliousness. Because if we're rebellious, He can't use us. Another characteristic of the ones that are kept, the true believers, is that they are able to love. Remember the stony heart couldn't keep the seed? We have a soft now. He's given us a fleshy heart now. We're willing to love. We're willing to take on hurt and burdens for ourselves to love one, to love another. Some can't love. Some can't love maybe now, but they're trying, they're growing, they're changing, and they are able to learn. And He knows the beginning from the end, and He knows what we're going to end up to be. And so He takes every opportunity to use as many people as He can call. But we know that many are called, but only a few are chosen for the kingdom. So the sea is the world and all the people, and He's casting out a net, and He's trying to bring in those that He wants. Many are called, few are chosen. That net is full of many, many, many different kinds of people. Some are hangers-on, some cleave to you. It says in Daniel, many will cleave to you by flatteries. They ain't going to make it. Even if you give them the benefit of the doubt, if they're not right before Yahweh, they ain't going to make it. It doesn't matter what you allow of them. We don't know someone else's heart. So we have these parables. These are mysteries because the world, the secular world, doesn't understand the calling. It doesn't understand how faith works. It doesn't understand. They don't understand how the Holy Spirit works. They don't understand that many are going to go into the lake of fire. How could this little baby Jesus, who had never hurt anybody, do such a thing? How could that be? Can't be. He wouldn't do a thing like that. They don't understand how Satan works. He comes to destroy. Not only does he come to bring up weeds that choke off and want to kill the plants, but sometimes he just sets the whole field of wheat on fire. Sometimes you do that with the tongue because it's a world of iniquity. You need to be careful of that. These are secrets. We know what the plan of salvation is. We know what the pearl of great price is. We know what the calling is and the greatness of that calling. We understand the greatness of his atonement. They don't even understand sin. That we were slaves and in bondage, and he came to set us free from sin, death, the devil, the penalty of sin, which is death, the second death. And now we're delivered of that. All these are mysteries. All these things we can explain to someone else because we know. And when you explain them to a carnal mind, they will still not understand. When you witness to someone, they will come back with carnal language. You're speaking spirit, they're caught talking carnal, and that's how you can tell they're not getting it. And if they're patient with you, you know what they're going to say to you? You know, Orville, I hear everything you had to say to me. And I know you love me and you really want to help. I can see the sincerity and the tears in your eyes about that I need to give my heart over to Yeshua and repent of my sins. And I have come short of the glory of Yahweh. And I see, in a sense, the way you explain it, that I've got natural sin. I know I'm selfish. I know I'm this and that. But I hear the words, but it doesn't do anything for me in here. And they'll tell you sometimes that they're not touched. It just isn't the time. But the seed is in there. But you can tell them, okay, Frank. Here we go, Corey. Here's Frank. Frank will say, I know you've told me this, and I'm going to remember this. I'm not going to forget what you told me, Orville. And Orville says, just hold on to that, because there might be a time your eyes will be opened. That's a mystery. Only the Spirit can do that. Yeah. So you tell them, remember what I told you on this day. Don't fight it. Just put it on the back burner. Just hold on to it. Just remember, because that can save your life.
Hallelujah.
And that's what you say to someone that will give you a couple of minutes. In a food store, wherever you are at, there's always an opportunity. The last great day. Let's go to John 7, 37, 38. That famous verse that Yeshua said on this day. This is the statement that was made on this day. In the synagogue, in the last day, that great day of the feast, that's the eighth day, the day when all the plan of salvation is complete and Yahweh our Father comes back. Yeshua stood and cried. He shrieked, that word is shrieked, cried with a loud voice, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Not unto somebody else. Come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Let's take a look at this. This is directly related to this day now. This is our last message for this feast and this day. I think it is. That word thirst, when you look it up in the Greek, means to be really thirsty, like you haven't drank anything for 2 or 3 days. I mean, you are athirst. You are thirsting to death. There's this deep desire. I got to have water soon or I'm going to be in trouble. That's the kind of thirst he's talking about. And that's what we ought to have, a burning, burning desire for what he has to say in reading that word. A burning desire to grab onto that truth, to grab that pearl of great price and everything he has to tell us. I want everything. Everything you're willing to give me, Yahweh, I thirst for this. I want it all. Feed me. I open my mouth. Fill it, the scripture says. Does it?
Hallelujah.
Some of us woke up. Sorry. Drink in the word. Drink in the word. Now this other one, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. That flow isn't a small trickle. It isn't a creek. It's like the rock that was smoked. The torrents, I mean, we're talking almost a Mississippi River, came rushing out of this rock so much that it cut a path in just a month or so, cut a path right through other boulders. That's how much water comes forth. And that's the power of the word that comes out of our mouth, that comes out of our belly, out of our heart, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And the word has power. The word is sharper than any two-edged sword, able to divide asunder the soul, the spirits, and the joints of the marrow, and is a discerner of the hearts and intents of the heart. thoughts and the intents of the heart. And when we open our mouth and share the word, coupled with the Spirit, because the Spirit is in the word, you want to witness? Witness by the word. Don't make it all your words. Don't paraphrase everything. Quote the word. The word has power the way it was written, the way it was intended, right out of the mouth and right by the Spirit, under the ones who wrote it down, moved by the Holy Spirit, as if they were moved by the Holy Spirit, it says. Right? Quote the word. When you pray, quote the word. When you do spiritual warfare, quote the word, because that's where the power is. His power that is beyond all understanding, beyond all carnal vision. And that will bring forth flowing waters. That flowing water is life. Water is life, and the truth is life. The word is life, and it comes forward in a torrent. Holy boldness, I think the sister said she wanted. Mm-hmm. Let it come forth and flow out. Be not afraid of their faces.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
I have made your forehead more adamant than flint. Ezekiel 3:8-9. Don't be afraid. Let it go. Whether they listen or they forbear. Isn't that what I said? Hey, go your own way. You don't want to hear this. Go your own way. Doesn't matter whether they hear or not. The word will either profit them or it will be a witness against them. Mm-hmm. In that day, which is just before this day. Because there's a great white throne judgment. And the books will be open. Secrets. Secrets. Why are you telling me this, Orville? Why are you talking to me, Orville, about this stuff? I don't want to hear this stuff. I told you I'm not interested in the first thing about religion or gods or eternal life and that junk. I don't care about anything except what I can feel and taste and smell. And I'm smelling you right now. You're talking to me about this. What are you doing this for? And you say, because I care about you. But be forewarned, because if you don't accept this, it'll be a witness against you. You were told. Now you're responsible, just like the woman in the ceramic shop. Mm-hmm. You tell me this, I'm responsible. She didn't want to hear it because she knew she'd be responsible. That was wisdom. She knew something to say that. Mm-hmm. Let's go to the kingdom. First there comes judgment. Before the kingdom comes, but after the seventh day reign of Yeshua, and between the time New Jerusalem comes back, there has to be judgment. Let's go to that judgment in Revelation 20. Verses 10 through 15. Judgment. The Day of Atonement represents two things. I just want to talk about this. This is not the Day of Atonement. But the point is this. The saints, one of their heritages, Psalms 150 and 149, is to judge the wicked. And the reason, in chapter 11 of Leviticus, chapter 16 of Leviticus, when the priest took two hands and put on the Azazel goat, Azazel means scapegoat or blame, the one who's blamed, let's blame him. That's Satan, that Azazel goat is Satan. He took two hands and put on the goat because one hand represents Yahshua judging the wicked, and we're the other hand. Two hands on top of the head of the goat. We will judge the wicked. There's a time of judgment coming. Now this great white throne judgment, this is before Father Yahweh, where the books are open. But there's a time of judgment, says in Revelation 20, verse 10 through 15, and the devil, Satan, the adversary, had deceived them, was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on the throne, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away. There was no hiding from. That's what that means. There was no hiding from this. Couldn't escape. And there was found no place for them, what, to hide. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before Yahweh. And the books were open, and another book was open. Books and another book. That sounds like three books to me. Books were open, and another book. And I would say that'd be the book of life, the book of death, the book of remembrance. Which is the book of life. The other book is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And we know that the seven spirits of Yahweh go through all the earth. We know the angels go through all the earth. And they report back every word that we speak. everything that we do is written down. Everything. In the book of remembrance. Everything that we do, can't hide. They see everything that we do. We are observed. We're in this school, we're in this class, and the big teacher is watching everything that we do. We're in training. And this life is not only, we're called two reasons to this life. We're born for two reasons. One, to get the message, and two, to learn our lessons. That's the big picture. It's real simple. That's a mystery. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell, that's the last enemy, death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire and burned up. Judgment first. There always has to be judgment. New Jerusalem. Revelation 21, 1 through 27. This is a good review. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city. This is what he saw and what is coming, what we're going to see. The holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. This is the place, Yeshua said, I go to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would tell you. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle, in other words, the dwelling place of Yahweh is with men. That has never happened before. Yahweh has never dwelt with men. Never. And he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and Yahweh himself, not Yahshua, Yahweh himself, shall be with them and be their mighty one or Elohim. And Yahweh shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. All these things, this flesh, mortality must put on immortality. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, all the tears, you know, we take a lot for granted. It's just life, isn't it? We cry, we're sad, we're happy, we're depressed, we get lonely. We fall, we bruise ourselves, we get hurt, we have pains and aches, especially with the age that we're getting to. And all that's going to be gone. Won't that be great?
Hallelujah.
No more feeling sluggish. I just don't feel like I got the energy to do this today. That's going to be gone.
Hallelujah.
No more colds.
Hallelujah.
Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. Yeshua says unto John, it is done. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. I will give unto him that is athirst the fountains of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. That's the pearl of great price. And I will be his Elohim, and he shall be my son. And that's what we heard this morning, that we went to Malachi 3:16 and 17. Wickedness left outside and destroyed. There isn't going to be any wickedness in the kingdom. And he says, now here's a description of wickedness. Here's a description of what is totally unacceptable within the righteous walls of Jerusalem. Fearful, the fearful. Fearful, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars. Proverbs 16. He hates lying, a lying tongue. All liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And there came unto me one of the angels which had the seven vials full of the seven last plagues, and talk with me, saying, come hither, and I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. Here comes the assembly. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the great city, holy or Kodesh Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from Yahweh. Having the glory of Yahweh, it shines like the sun. And her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like jasper stone, clear as crystal. And had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates. At the gates 12 angels, and names written thereof, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. Now listen to this. See if this brings to memory something else in the Pentateuch. On the east, 3 gates. And on the north, 3 gates. And on the south, 3 gates. And the west, 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Remember that the tabernacle in the wilderness, they would stop and they would pitch the tabernacle. There would be 3 tribes on the north, on the south, on the east, on the west. Now, that was a picture of the holy city. Now, there will be doors. Gates with the names of the tribes. You think the names of the tribes are not important? That Israel, the concept of Israel is not important? It sure is. It sure is. What is the foundation of everything that's in the kingdom? What is the foundation to all that we know, all we understand? It's what the apostles preached. And they preached Yahshua and all he had to say, his word. The doctrine of anti-Messiah, which is 2 John, says, he that does not abide in the doctrine of Messiah is an anti-Messiah. The doctrine of Messiah is 2 things. I've said this several times, but I think this is important because we don't want to be deceived. We don't want to say to ourselves when a heretic comes along, well, that's just another way to understand something. That's just another way to verbalize something that's hard to understand. No, it isn't. You ask a oneness person, how many are there in the head, in the Godhead? How many are there? 1, 2, or 3? Just give me an answer. And when they start talking around, well, that's hard to say, and you know, that's you know, this is too complicated, and they start waffling, you know that they're oneness. Because all you got to say is 2. Real simple. The doctrine of anti-Messiah in 2 John is 2 things. The doctrine of anti-Messiah, not abiding in the doctrines of Messiah, is the 2 things. 1, who Messiah is in all that he is. Virgin birth, pre-existed, 3 days, 3 nights, sinless, sits at the right hand as intercessor, high priest of the order of Melchizedek forever and ever. All of those things, right? Intercessor. Separate person, separate spirit, separate calling, separate office. Sonship, not father, he is son. A son is not a father. He's kind of like the father. He might believe all the father believes. He might look like the father, but he's not the father. He's the son. It's a separate person. The other part of anti-Messiah that they have to believe to be in the doctrine of Messiah, 2 John, is what he said. Doesn't matter if you believe who he is. If you don't believe what he said, it's no count. It amounts to nothing. And if you believe what he said, but you don't believe who he is, what he said makes no difference, because you have not him if you don't believe the word. Make sense? I have to abide in the doctrine of Messiah, 2 John. And he that talketh with me had a golden reed to measure the city, and the gates thereof, and the wall thereof. And the city lieth 4 square. The length is the length, and the breadth, and the measure of the city, with the reed 12,000 furlongs. And I think we said 1,500 miles, Roy? The city is 1,500 miles, 4 square, including the height. The length and the breadth and the height are equal, and measured the wall thereof, 144 cubits. Oh boy, there's a number, 144. According to the measure of a man. As I understand it, this is a cubit. From here to here.
Right
here. It's about 18 inches. About. And the building of the walls of it was as jasper, and the city was of pure gold, like unto clear glass. and the foundations of the walls of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. And it goes into all the precious stones. And I imagine that someone has an interpretation of what these stones mean. But I don't have that interpretation. Does anybody know? Every one of those stones means something. Let's go down.
Was that the stones on the priest? Represent that?
I think it is.
Yeah, the same stones.
I think it is. On the Urim and Thummim.
Mm-hmm.
That he gave to the high priest, and they would light up and give answers. And every one of them represents one of the tribes of Israel. And I don't know if there's any more interpretation than that. And I saw no temple therein, for Yahweh, our Elohim Almighty, and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither the moon, to shine in it. For the glory of Yahweh did lighten it, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. Now, I hadn't seen that before. Nations of them which are saved. Those are the ones who are going to come up to Jerusalem, it says in Zechariah 14. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory and their honor to it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day. For there shall be no night there. That means they're not going to be closed ever again. And there shall bring... And they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations unto it, and there shall in no wise enter in it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Didn't we say that the apostles came back and they said, Master, all these spirits are subject unto us? He said, don't give that. That's not important. Rejoice and be glad because your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Why? Because they believed everything Yeshua had to say of what can be done, because we're still in the New Testament assembly, and we believe what they did then, we do this now, and we do all the Word, stepping out in faith. Our names are written in the Book of Life. In fact, one sister here has seen, we asked her to be shown in the Spirit her name in the Book of Life, and she saw it. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of Yahweh and the Lamb, and in the midst of the street of it. Now there, either side of the river, there was the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yieldeth her fruit every month, and the leaves of the trees were for the healing of the nations. What was the good fruit that the apostles brought forth? Righteousness. Right? The word of righteousness. So everything means something. And everything, almost everything, points to the kingdom, the final outcome. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of Yahweh and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. See, we're not going to just be on, we said this morning, we're not going to be on cloud nine, just... We're finished, we're done, and now we're on vacation. That isn't going to happen. And they shall see his face, and his name, here it is. You think the name's not important? His name shall be in their foreheads. And they shall be, there shall be no night there, and no need of candle, neither light of the sun, for Yahweh Elohim giveth them light. And they shall reign, that means have leadership, power, authority, dominion. They shall reign forever and ever. And I believe that means Yahweh and Yeshua, and it means us also. And it says, Yeshua is the way, the truth, and the light. Doesn't it? And the life. And he said unto me, these things are faithful and true. Yahweh Elohim of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings, the prophecy of this book. The interpretation is sure. In conclusion, we would say today, as we finish this last great day, in fact, we only have an hour and 45 minutes left to this last great day. Yahweh is mighty and mighty to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And all of these things. All my bones shall say, who is like unto thee?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Oh. Yahweh is a revealer of secrets and mysteries, and he reveals them only to his people because it encourages them and they need to know. He knows that they need to know the big picture. And doesn't he give us wisdom? His commandments and the things that he gave to Israel were to make them wiser than all the rest. Isn't it true? He reveals to them only, the only ones he reveals to are the ones he can trust. He tells only who his friends are. That's another statement we've gone over several times. All these are characteristics of the elect and the ones who are called unto salvation, written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The secrets are the secrets of the universe. How was it created? How long did it take? How long will it last? What will happen to it? Who's going to own it? Secrets of the universe. The secrets are the secrets of life and blessing. Didn't Moses say, "This day I have laid before you blessing and cursing, life and death. Choose life, that you and your seed may live." Darkness hides the answers. Darkness hides the truth. Light reveals the secrets. Light reveals the truth. Light reveals the way. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path, which is written in Psalm
119:105.
My wife's favorite scripture. Yahshua is the light that reveals the secrets of the kingdom. He said, "I came to reveal the word of my Father and do all the things. I tell you all the things my Father has taught me." All we have to do is listen to him. We have a calling. We know it takes two callings. No one comes to the Father except by me, and no one comes to me except the Father draws him. We have to have two drawings. And we can't come unto the Father unless we have Yahshua. And a lot of believers out there don't have Yahshua. If they don't have Yahshua, they have not the Father, they have nothing. John 15:15, in conclusion, one of our last verses, "Henceforth I call you not servants." He says, "I call you friends." John 14:2-3. "In my Father's house there are many mansions. This is the eighth great day. If it were not so, I'd tell you, but I go and prepare a place for you. And I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." So as we said earlier today, in all this word and all these secrets and all the things that have been given unto us in Israel, remember who we are. Forget not who we are in this great, great calling of this last great day. Yahweh bless and keep you all in the name of Yahshua. Let him bless you and keep you. Let his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Let Yahweh lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And they shall put the name of Yahweh upon Israel, and he shall bless them.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to sing the song, "The Race is Nearly Finished." I know I did it once already, but some of you didn't hear it. And well, it's coming draweth nigh, so I'm going to. And since this is the last day, I'd like to sing with you.
We're living in the last days. The mark will soon be near. The home stretch lies before us. Let's finish this race with joy. We're going down the home stretch. The race is nearly done. I call, we're almost finished, that race that we begun. I can see the finish line, I can see the finish line. I can see Yeshua waiting, waiting at the finish line. Arms outstretched to his children as they cross that finish line. Be it life or death, he's waiting, waiting at the finish line. We're going down the home stretch, the race is nearly done. Like Paul, we're almost finished that race that we begun. I can see the finish line. I can see the finish line. I can see Yeshua waiting, waiting at the finish line. There's a crown of life just waiting when we cross that finish line. Yeshua will wipe away all tears when we reach the finish line. We're going down the home stretch, the race is nearly done. Like Paul, we're almost finished that race that we begun. I can see the finish line. I can see the finish line. I can see Yeshua waiting, waiting at the finish line. I can see Yeshua waiting, waiting at the finish line. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I've had a request to sing wedding music again.
Heavenly preparation for the wedding celebration.
coming soon.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, I'll be with you till we meet again. By his counsel, guide and hold you. With his sheep securely fold you. Yeah, I'll be with you till we meet again. Till we meet. Bestowed upon us during this feast, all the good fellowship,
and all the comfort that we received, all the prayers that went forth, and much, much joyous rejoicing.
Hallelujah.
We ask, Father, that this continue as we receive, as we go home. We go home rejoicing, knowing that we have indeed reached many victories this week.
Hallelujah.
The theme of the feast was, we were looking forward to victories, and we did indeed receive them over Satan.
Hallelujah.
We've had times when people tried to infiltrate, tried to disrupt us. We've had problems with some sickness that was rebuked. Gotten a victory over that.
Hallelujah.
Gotten a victory over many evil spirits, Father. Hallelujah. Through prayer, deliverance.
Hallelujah.
And many other things that we enjoyed during this feast, and all the good food we had.
Hallelujah.
And with the skill of those who prepared it, and all the willing hands that cleaned up after us. We're truly grateful, Father, for
Hallelujah.
All these many blessings. Blessings of safety getting down here.
Yes.
Although we have, some of us had been sought and buffeted by Satan, trying to keep us away.
Hallelujah.
We came anyway.
Hallelujah.
Received a great blessing thereby.
Hallelujah.
And received the blessing of true brotherhood in this feast.
Hallelujah.
And we ask, Father, that this spirit stay with us. Spirit of brotherhood, truth, and righteousness stay with us.
Hallelujah.
That we can buffet the Satan and continue to keep him under our feet.
Hallelujah.
We ask, Father, a blessing for those who are about to travel, that they have an uneventful trip going home.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank
keep
you,
the critters away from us, and keep the critters off the road, that we have no problems. And the traffic be such that they stay out of our way. And all things we get home safely and in good order. All these things we praise you for.
Hallelujah.
And all
Hallelujah.
The outreach ministry blessed.
Hallelujah.
Full. And with the tape ministry too, Father. We ask that continued blessing upon this house.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And keep us all in good health, that we continue on drawing people in.
Hallelujah.
For the harvest is ripe, Father, we know. For all those who are searching, let them come. Let them find the truth that once was delivered to the saints, that Hallelujah. We also have found throughout the scriptures. And let us receive those promises, those great promises that Yahshua gave to us so many centuries ago, as we, the remnant of those people, continue on earnestly testing for the faith that once delivered to the saints. All these things we pray for in Yahshua's precious name.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Man up here, watch out for the wire. Oh, look at these faces. Look at all these faces. We're going to go all the bomb.
Do they smile as much when you're up here preaching?
No.
Talking to the band. You need to go behind your dad.
There we go.
Awesome.
For those who are confused,
it's not going to work.
Not going to make it all.
Cindy, for those who are confused, this is the front. This is the way you face.
Okay.
Cindy's confused.
She's trying to get the shorter people in front.
Okay, you're
pushing. Okay, I think we're going to have a row on their knees. We're going to have a row of men in the front on their knees or something.
Okay.
Oh boy.
All the Ahab spirits, come up front and get on your knees.
I can get down. Then some other people.
I'm sorry, honey.
Isaac, you come up in front, because you're too short. Isaac, you don't show up.
Yeah, come on, you're too short.
You're in the front. Cora's in the front.
Get down, Cora. You can't stand up. You'd be too tall.
All right, get down. Isaac.
Isaac, come here.
Down your knees, right by your dad there. That'll be good.
There you go.
There you go.
Up, yeah, get up to him enough so we can get you in the picture.
All right, that's looking pretty good. We got Rachel there. We can't quite see.
Orville?
There you go.
Oh, there. Oh, that's better.
Where's Orville at?
Orville's
not
here.
He's not hiding.
Here, what do you think? I'd be right here.
Mr. Redbuck. Give me some of that.
Well, I got them both. Hallelujah.
Well, I can't take it with the camera.
Well, let me get in, or you get in.
Spill some of that popcorn.
I'm
saying.
Get down here. Brother Mike, right here on the end.
Let's see.
You're not listening to me. I'm saying I can't take it with the camera.
The javelin catcher.
Well, maybe this will work.
Can you get us all in?
I can't if I move over here, but I couldn't over there because the camera's in the way.
Now, you want to be close enough that you cut everything else out so you have as close to the faces as possible.
Honey, I know how to
take pictures. I knew that. I'm sorry.
Just in case.
Smile, everybody.
Jeez. Hey. Yeah.
We take one more to make sure we get
these. No, don't anybody move because I want to take a picture too.
Orville Redenbacher.
No, it's Orville Wright.
Let's see. You and I are getting. Well, you have a camera too.
I have a camera.
Would you take our picture too?
Yes, I will.
Yeah, okay. I'll sit up right here.
Wow, what a good looking group.
Hey.
This is awesome looking. Hey. Till then. Horrible. It's not going to work.
You have a big picture of Linda you can hold out by your side.
I should get it. Hang on, let me see.
Okay, ready?
Got a little one.
Cheese.
Cheese.
Hold on,
I'm going to do it again.
Okay. Now one.
Yeah.
One more?
Take one with our camera.
Okay, hang on. Down again. Down one more time, Dennis.
Okay, wait.
Is this the button here on top?
Rough on the knees,
ain't
it, brother?
Yeah. Okay.
Down,
Dennis.
Down.
Wasn't turned on. Just a
second.
Yeah. Uh-oh. You gotta wind the film.
No.
The light comes on, right, when it's ready?
Yeah, it's on.
Okay.
Yeah. It only takes a second for it to come on.
Mm-hmm. Ready?
Yeah, okay. That was all the film.
That won't.
No, it wasn't recorded.
What are you doing that for?
I'm sorry, I thought it was all set up.
He's not 3 foot tall over here.
Yeah.
Has it got something to do? You don't know how my camera works?
Mercy on that boy. That's horrible wrong.
Yeah. Oh, I hate to get up, man. Yeah. I don't know if I get up.
Misfire.
Rachel, you need to,
Get over this.
Everybody stay tuned.
Orville, cut it out now.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Hallelujah.
Now let's get some pictures of individual families before we take care of the cameras.
Goodbye, sweet sign.